PG. It contains themes and scenes which may not be suitable for very young audiences. Parental guidance is advised.
Be advised that the views and opinions of the hosts and guests do not reflect those of the station.
Laimbag grabi, masantos siya sa labin si kayo amin, marahin na banggi sa Indogabos. Maayong gabi sa Tibok Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao, up to Sabah. Bismillah rahmanir rahim, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. Ako po si Eric Espina, ito po ang inyong nag-iisang republika. May kasabihan po sa Ingles na the opportunity favors the prepared. Ang ating po pag-uusapan ngayon ay may kinalaman po sa tinatawag nating ASEAN Economic Integration ng halos ay 10 bansa na kasama na po ang Pilipinas. Ito po ay naging in force and effect nitong unang araw ng Enero 2015. Alamin po natin kung ano magiging epekto nito sa merkado ng ating bansa, sa ekonomiya ng ating bansa. Kaya't iba't ibang mga tao ang ating inangyayahan sa gabing ito upang bigyan tayo ng perspektiba kung magiging masalimuot, maganda, maaliwalas ang magiging pananaw sa susunod na mga iilang taon. Unang-una sa lahat, siyempre, para kompleto po, simulan natin. Meron tayong kaibigan na taga-media naman at merong siya po ay presidente ng Philippine Association of Publishers Incorporated, si Ginoong Louis Ariola. Siya rin po ay isang may programa. Boses po nito ay pang FM. Meron din po tayong isang negosyante. Importante po ang negosyante dito sa usaping ito. Walang iba kundi si Ginoong George Chua. Siya rin po ay isang kolumnista sa aking paboritong newspaper na Manila Bulletin. Abangan niyo po ang aking isusulat itong Thursday sa column ko. Abangan niyo po yan. And then, of course, we have an economist. What is a conversation without an economist? We have Butch Valdez. Okay, good evening to everybody.
Good evening. Good evening.
Okay, to start on the neutral ground, let's talk to Louis. Louis, your take as far as media is concerned, as far as the publication business is concerned, the ASEAN integration, 100 million population, now your market is 600 million?
Well, I'm publishing the ASEAN Times.
Yes.
I started doing that 9 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Pakita during, naman natin.
During the economic ASEAN summit in Cebu.
Okay.
And I noticed at the time that there was no single publication about ASEAN.
Okay.
So I saw the market, I saw the need for it, and so I started publishing ASEAN Biz Times. At that time, Biz Times, because we don't want to talk about anything else but business only.
Okay.
Politics is about to be way out of that situation at the time.
Mm.
Even now, when we go into integration, by December, actually it will start December 31 of 2015.
Okay.
It will only be about economic integration.
Okay.
Wala pa yung ibang ano dyan, wala pa yung migration, wala pa yung political consideration. So there are, as you said in your program, in the intro of your program, that if we are prepared,
yes,
that's the best antidote for fear.
Yes.
So there's nothing to fear as far as I'm concerned. Because, as you said also, there will be a bigger market from 100 million to more than 600 million.
Uh-huh.
And we'll be competing with 9 other countries, and we are the best as far as English proficiency is concerned. So, communication-wise, I think we are better prepared than many of our neighbors.
Okay.
But let's not remain there. Uh-huh. We should prepare more. We cannot be complacent mm-hmm. at this time. So I guess our two colleagues here are doing just that.
The Singaporeans might disagree with you that we have a better English than their Singhalese. I don't know. Do you agree with that?
Well, their English is UK English. So okay. you have to ready your ear before you can understand mm-hmm. correctly what they're talking about.
Uh-huh. But how about in publications? And how do you see this media, affecting media?
Well, I will have more. As far as I'm concerned, I will have more readership.
Market.
Okay.
I will have more people buying the papers, you know. And there is more news. There is more products to launch. There is more services to launch. There are more areas to sell in the case of tourism.
Do you see media companies from other countries within ASEAN, you know, establishing their own TV channels here? Or do you see our own big networks moving
I don't
services.
Think so at the moment. Maybe our programs, certain programs. You know, even like I was in Vietnam 2 months ago, when you open the television, especially during the peak hours, the prime time, it's all telenovela from the Philippines.
Okay.
With the word Vietnamese below.
Okay.
Same thing, you know, in like Eat Bulaga, for example, in Indonesia.
It's Indonesia already, yes.
If you go to Indonesia, that's one of the byword, Eat Bulaga. Mm-hmm. So I can see our program, our programs here being marketed.
We can expect that in terms of just publication, generally speaking, they have to tailor fit this to basically business so that it becomes non-controversial.
Business, tourism, education.
And avoid the political side of the spectrum because each country has its own restrictions in terms of politics. No?
Yes, yes.
That's
yes.
the way to work at it.
That's correct.
In terms of media and publication.
That's correct, yes.
Okay. George Chua, you're talking about 608 million population to be exact, 12.176 trillion combined income for the 10 countries, an average GDP of 13.5 thousand. So, as a businessman, what is that? Is that what does that ring for you?
Well, first of all, I think those numbers are very impressive. Uh-huh. And even before we got into 2015, the ASEAN integration was already a done deal.
Okay.
Primarily because we've already reduced tariff rates.
Yes.
From our ASEAN neighbors. For more than 95% of all of the tariff codes, no?
Actually, the 10 countries, I think 99%.
So basically, it's really been more advantageous for countries that are exporting to us. And that's the reason why these have become more progressive countries than us.
And again, repeat that. Okay. It's more it's more profitable for those exporting to us.
Okay, countries take advantage of lower tariffs.
Of course, yes.
When they have less barriers
maximize
in the form
profits,
of... Yes, because now it becomes easier for them to sell abroad when there are no tariffs, customs duties and taxes, no? So I think to a large extent, countries such as Thailand have taken full advantage of that by becoming the production hub for the automotive industry, for Japanese manufacturers, for American manufacturers, and we have become the... recipient country for a lot of their exports, no?
Okay.
And that's the reason why I'm also a member of the Board of Trustees of the Chamber of Automotive Manufacturers of the Philippines.
Okay.
The statistics will show that the completely built up units as a percentage of the locally assembled vehicles have gotten to be bigger and bigger, meaning to say there are fewer and fewer vehicles locally assembled as compared to those that are coming completely built up.
Okay.
And I think that has been contributory to what you have read in the newspapers today, mm-hmm. That we still have 12 million Filipinos out of a job, no?
Yes.
Primarily because a lot of these people cannot be employed by call centers because of the lack of proper training, education, and therefore their job opportunities are very limited. Mm-hmm. And in the manufacturing sector, it's very forgiving in the sense that a lot of jobs can be for less qualified people. people yes. without college degrees
yes.
can find a job in a factory, you know,
yes.
whether it's to package certain things, to move things from one place to another,
tailoring,
to,
yeah,
many other things. Yes, no, yes. But certainly the services sector, like call centers, while it's good, it's been helpful to the economy,
yes.
it's not the solution. It's not the only solution that yes. we will need to work on. We need to work on multifaceted basis of being able to expand the employment base in the Philippines.
Okay. What do you think are the, I don't want to use the word sunrise because that was the term used a long time ago. What are the sunrise industries of the Philippines that we can be very optimistic in terms of what possible sectors?
Well, if you take a look at the statistics, no, the OFWs, no, I don't know if exporting
always,
Filipinos is an industry in itself.
Yes.
No? Undeniably, without OFWs, we would have been bankrupt long ago.
So are we saying that we will be exporting OFWs to ASEAN markets?
I think that's going to happen because there are less and less job opportunities here.
Abroad.
Just to give you an example, while we have the PPP program,
yes.
no?
Yes, Pantawid program.
Pantawid Pamilya Pilipino program, no?
Yes.
What has really happened there is that it has become a handout of sorts.
A dole out
yeah. without really being able to generate the job opportunities, the ongoing
skills training
and things like that. And also the challenges of being able to better yourself, no? Because you're doing something. The traditional Filipino of sipag and tiyaga type of thing
okay.
has been eroded by waiting for the money to come in
mm-hmm.
by just doing nothing, by just being poor, no? So the sad thing about it is that all of that money, 60 plus billion pesos,
okay.
has not been put to good use. Well, of course, you might say that, no, but people have benefited from
it
that.
It puts They're, people on education,
yeah, but,
it feeds them.
But in reality, it could have been used to greater good. Because
you're saying
we have
it could have been further maximized.
Yes, by providing job opportunities, by helping out small and medium industries establish their own businesses, and many other things that would improve the employability of certain underprivileged segments of society.
Okay.
Yeah.
Butch, you were there several presidents ago. There were
yeah.
so many economic programs.
Thank you for...
Even under Ferdinand. Institutional memory is very important, you know, because it brings us to
yeah.
where we are now and missed opportunities. I think that's also
well,
another thing, no?
First of all, I'd like to say that, of course, I agree with what has just been said by Louis and by George on this concept of integration and how we can take advantage of it. No? The concept of integration has been set up even as early as Macapagal's time,
yes,
right?
Yes.
When the CETO and then after
Seattle,
that the
yeah.
ASEAN, okay?
Yeah.
And the idea of integrating our economies was always and always there. But how to do it no, was what
was
a bit problematic. No?
Mm-hmm.
Because at some point, some countries decided all the way up to the end of 1980, before the end of 1970s, no, we decided to be all trying to produce, no, producer nations.
Yes.
Moving towards a certain level of industrialization.
Yes, yes.
And looking at the basic infrastructural requirements of our countries in order to be able to do this. No? And some actually did.
Yes.
However,
and we should have.
In our case, now I just wanted to precisely to point out, it was decided for us and by our own leadership at the time
yes.
and all the way up to today
yeah.
that we will be a service economy.
I'm going to cut you there. We're going to pause for a few reminders because that's a very interesting point when we return. Mm-hmm.